Good evening, everyone. We'll call our meeting to order. Joy, would you please call the roll?
Hallie.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Revelinsky.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Great, thank you. Council, any additions to this evening's agenda?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to add a committee report of the ambulance committee.
Fine, we'll add that at the end of our committee reports. Okay, that's everything. Well, then we'll move to our consent agenda. We have approval of minutes from the October 24th council meeting, also our special meeting on November 2nd. Approval of payroll in the amount of $83,945.05. We have approval of the October finance report, approval of liquor licenses for Hy-Vee C-Store and the Cider House, and approval of claims in the amount of $1,456,389.95, of which we have one payment of $1,120,194.17 to SM Hennages and Sons. And Mike, that we understand that is part of phase one?
Correct, Mayor.
Okay, great, thank you. Any questions regarding these consent agenda items? Not entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Thompson. Please call the roll.
Anderson.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Revelinsky.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
All right, thank you. Now we'll move to our resolutions and action items, ordinances. First is the consideration of an authorization to sell surplus city-owned equipment. And Council, you have a list of those items. Mike, could I ask you to go over some of those areas, where they come from, and how we're going to run the auction?
Absolutely. Thank you, Mayor. So attached in your packet is a list of items that mostly, as you can see, has been seized from our police department. And then on the back, there are a couple vehicles listed that we have replaced and no longer use as a city, as well as a couple pieces of equipment, a trash pump, a jackhammer, and a dry erase board that department heads have deemed that there is no public benefit to keeping these items, and so they've asked your permission to declare them as surplus and take them to public auction. I believe Daryl has identified an auction coming up on the 5th in which we will take these items contingent to your approval. We pay I believe it's 10% listing fee, or the auctioneer retains 10% of the sale, and then we can dispose of these items.
Okay, Council, so I'd entertain a motion to approve the items of equipment for disposal.
So move.
Moved by Rasmussen.
Second.
Second by Revelinsky. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, Council will move to an action item. This would be consideration of establishing a TIF fund account for North Campus Village Phase 5. And Joy, if we could ask you to comment on this, since we'd understand that essentially we do need to set up a separate account for the funds that would flow through that over the period of time of the TIF.
Yeah, the state of Iowa has gotten pretty particular on how you report your TIF funds. And it's, before we had one across the board, now we've broken them down into each TIF district. So this new one, the North Campus Village, I need to create a new fund so we can follow, it's easier for record keeping to keep everything separate. So I just need to create a new fund and would like approval.
Okay, thank you, Joy.
Move for approval.
Moved by Revelinsky to approve the creation of the new fund.
Second.
For TIF fund, second by Anderson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, Council, we will be setting a public hearing. This is for annexation request for a portion of the North Campus Village Phase 5 project. We'll set that for our next meeting, November 28th, our regular council meeting. So we're simply setting a date, so we'll entertain a motion to approve the public hearing for November 28th.
So moved.
Moved by Thompson.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, Council, along with the North Campus Village Project and Vostu Partners, we have a proposal to enter into a development agreement. So we're going to hold a public hearing on that and then consider the development agreement. Martha, are there any comments from the Economic Development Committee on?
We have no further, there's nothing further from Economic Development regarding that.
Right, but your committee is recommending this to the council?
We are recommending, yes.
Great. Thank you. And Mike, anything that we need to point out in the agreement the council should be aware of?
Thank you, Mayor. Just to highlight the resolution that's in your packet, this is sort of a condensed version of the development agreement, which basically states that Mr. Brett will construct 100% LMI units in that particular area. He's going to construct approximately 56 units. His minimum investment in the area will be $5 million. However, it's more likely that he'll actually invest closer to $7.2 million by the time the units are finished construction. The rebate agreement for Mr. Brett, will be for 10 years, and it will be at 90% of the actual increment received, not to exceed $1.5 million for a total rebate to Mr. Brett. So again, it's not a guaranteed $1.5 million. It's a not to exceed. It's 90% of the increment for 10 years of what we actually receive. The other 10% of that receipt, because it's LMI housing, will go into the LMI set-aside fund that this body can determine how you'd like to use those funds as they come in for LMI projects down the road. Basically, the remainder of the resolution states that we're acting in accordance with state law and that the resolution and this agreement is in the best interest of the city. That is a condensed version of what is contained in the development agreement for your consideration this evening.
Council, any questions? Okay. This is a public hearing. I'll ask if there's any public comment at this time on the development agreement. If not, we'll close the public hearing and move to the resolution to approve the development agreement with Vostu Partners, LLC.
I move we accept the development agreement with Vostu Partners.
Moved by Thompson.
Second
by Anderson. I think you in there first. All right, any other discussion? Now please call the roll.
Thompson.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Revolinsky.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Next, council, we will be setting a date for by resolution, and that would be to meet on the authorization of the loan agreement for the sewer revenue capital loan notes. So that meeting would be set also at our, would be set for November 28th, our next meeting, this public hearing on consideration of those loan notes. So entertain
a motion to approve that resolution.
Approve the resolution. Thank you, Darren. Moved by Hamilton.
Second.
Second by Revolinsky. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, we have a resolution declaring official intent under Treasury Regulation 1.150-2 to issue debt to reimburse the city for certain original expenses paid in connection with specified projects. So, Mike, this gives us the opportunity to capture funds that get spent before we actually borrow the money.
That's correct, Mayor. Okay. That very well said. Very similar to what we moved on step one. This allows us to reach back for 60 days prior to the actual borrow to reimburse ourselves for expenses we submitted or obtained on behalf of that project.
That would include some of the legal fees and those kind of things and also.
Correct. That's correct.
Okay. And are we paying those out of particular funds so that we can track them at this point so we know exactly where all of those expenditures are?
Absolutely. Excellent question, Mayor. We have established separate, not funds, but line items within our general or our wastewater treatment account to track those expenditures. We have wastewater treatment plant, we have step one, and we have step two that we keep track, very detailed records of exactly what expenses, including legal fees, that we expense for each particular project.
Okay. Thank you. Council, any other questions? If not, entertain a motion to approve this resolution.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Thompson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, council, we have Consideration adoption of City Council's rules of procedure, and I understand this has gone through the Personnel Committee, and Councilman Hallie, if you could give us some background on this.
Sure, thank you. This is something that Mike and I were inspired to take a look at after attending the Iowa League of Cities annual conference. It's considered a best practice to formalize the City Council rules, how we do our business, how the public interacts with us. So I'm just going to hit some of the highlights. Most of it, I think the bulk of it, is just a repeat of what we already do, but just want to hit a few of the issues that, well, there will be two that we need to actually decide on. But so in the beginning, it says that we want the portion of this that refers to public comment to be made in a condensed format available to the public at our meeting. So once this is adopted, we want to put the general rules of seeking permission to speak from the chair before talking, et cetera, for the public. And that may help with some of the issues that we have at times when, especially, there's a hot topic. If you cut down to number five, attendance, we're saying the city administrator, attorney, and city clerk are expected to attend every council meeting, but city employees, in terms of department heads, are only required as required. So if there's a reason for them to be there, if there's something on the agenda that we need them to speak on, then they're expected. But otherwise, we're not saying that the department heads are expected to be at every council meeting. Council member non-attendance, there is a question on that we need to address. Mr. Thompson brought up a question. He's been on many boards, as have I, that have a minimum attendance requirement. So say somebody gets elected to the seat and never shows up to the meetings, we have no formal way of I suppose you say, reprimanding or asking them to meet some minimum. So that is something. Tom, do you want to propose something on that, or do you want to, it was your idea, I just wanted you to...
Well, I don't know. I don't see if Mr. Morris, I don't know that because we are elected officials. The board's answer on my, we're appointed.
So my understanding of
elected official, if they can be replaced.
I read the city code in terms of what it says about the council. It says that we set our own rules governing our own body, and that, to me, I think that... John, can you come and just answer a quick question about this?
I never answer quick.
Oh, well, that's right. Sorry. I don't know what I was thinking. All right. So in terms of if the council wanted to set a minimal percentage of meetings that we expect
Council members to attend.
Is that within our right in terms of the code?
I don't think it is.
No?
Frankly, it's an elective position. You can't remove someone from office. You can remove them for statutory reasons. I mean, if somebody never comes to council, that would be malfeasance or dereliction of duty, and you could raise that under the statute. But you don't need a separate rule on it, because that would just be part of what's expected of a public officer.
So if it's not listed in our code, but our code does say that the council has the authority to govern itself, then right. what is the...
Well, your state code is still going to preempt that as far as removal of officers and rights that everybody has as an elected officer. That sets the tone for anybody that's elected.
Okay.
You could certainly... spell out your criteria as far as what you regard as dereliction or failure on the part of an elected person.
Yeah, so I don't know if Tom meant so far as to try to remove someone from the council, but just setting some standard that we
expect. Most of the boards that I attend, there's a minimum requirement of 75%.
Yeah.
I mean, that's you know. But again, but those are appointed positions. Those are not elected.
Yeah. Right. Well, it does state in this that, as we do with our ordinances, that nothing in here can go against the state code in terms of council members.
I think you'd be restricted to the removal from office sections, but they give you a lot of latitude if you've got facts to support malfeasance or failure to perform.
What do you think?
Comment? Yep. I don't really perceive that as an issue on our council. I haven't really felt like that's an issue in the 20 years I've been on council. So I don't think it's something that we need to just all of a sudden put in just because we want a rule about it. I think the way you have it worded, that it's be polite and give notice if you're not going to be there. And I think we could, if something would come up, we could always deal with it at that time. But ultimately, it's that person running for election, re-election. If he's not considered doing his job, then maybe someone else will run and beat him. I don't really think we got to spend a lot of time on that.
Just to back up,
it hasn't been an issue in the time I've been involved.
But we hope it would never be an issue. this actual format and this actual content came from, was it five other cities that we looked at? So, and here in Iowa, and there was no mention in any of them of a minimal attendance. Yeah. So, if you're okay, Tom.
I'm fine.
Okay, so we're just going to not go down that path. All right. This is interesting. So for the agenda preparation, a council member may request that a certain item be on the agenda. The mayor does have the right to remove it, but if the council member wishes not to have it removed, he or she may get a second council member to, again, we hope this never comes to it, but this is check and balances. If two council members make a formal request, then the item stays on the agenda. So these are just some of the things that, if it came to it, but this is the checks and balances our government is built on.
Give some definition to the bully pulpit. Bully mayor.
Yeah, no bully mayor. That's right. No bully council. All right, on page 5, it's just says, it is the duty of each official to review and familiarize themselves with the contents of the agenda prior to the meeting. And this is something, this is a fairness to our department heads and to our city administrator and all our staff. To the greatest extent possible, if the council has questions, ask them by noon, the day of the meeting, not at the meeting. Because if you ask a detailed question that the person is not prepared for and doesn't have the information, you essentially are causing the whole thing to be delayed. So just as a courtesy, if you have a question that you want detailed information on, if it's for Mike, if it's for Joy, email them, call them. If it's for a department head, reach out to them. But try not to bring it up at the meeting when it's time to actually discuss and hopefully vote on it. I'm trying to get as much preparation as possible ahead of time.
I have a little trouble with that, Mike, because what can appear to the public is that we're taking care of everything on our own quietly, and then when the meeting's there, we're just kind of railroading it through without properly explaining things. I think if someone has a question, just from a common sense point of view on something, and I understand ultimately, there might, you don't want to waste time on things, but if questions come up about it, then I've always felt this way about being on council. If something doesn't just automatically strike me as making sense, I like to bring it up in public, because I feel if I have that question, other people have that question, and they deserve to understand all the nuances of it. It's like what we don't want to be is a group of people who we know best and don't worry about. We got it covered, guys. Mm-hmm. I think we want to be a very transparent operation so that people can feel participatory. So I have trouble with that language.
This doesn't say don't ask the question. This says give the person you're asking the question a chance to research it and give you a better answer.
Submit it early.
So there's nothing that says don't ask questions in public. This says, now, it's our job to be prepared, right? And it's our staff's job to be prepared for our questions. We should know more than the average public person about this stuff, because that's why we elected.
So you can ask the question, not that they're going to email you the answer before the meeting.
No, it's not getting it. Just giving them a prep so that they can give
you
that
information. Submit the question early.
Yep.
That you will ask during the council.
It's just a courtesy. It's not a rule that you're going to get in trouble for breaking. But
I think if it's a definition, if it's an explanation of what meeting preparedness is and responsibility is, I think that's fine. But I think you get into a little bit of a tight area as to whether, if someone raises a detailed question during a discussion of an item during the meeting, how are you going to really make that determination at that point in time that should have been discussed earlier, or it's legitimately discussed now? It creates a little bit of value. Who's making that kind of a judgment? But I think in terms of whatever language we use to encourage meeting preparation as part of the responsibility of council members, fine.
I think the general rule would think, could that department head or could that city staff person answer it on the spot? Or are you asking them, give me a 5-year comparison of the use of this facility or something that they couldn't possibly have? If you want it to be at that meeting for that discussion and you know you want it by noon of that day, then ask it. And that's a simple.
So my only point would be, so that given our history, and there, a few people have been around for a few years and had some history. So I mean, I don't know that there's an example where we haven't been able to cordially just say, we need more information, let's table this and bring it back to the next meeting.
Yeah, that's
our way of dealing with this, as opposed to putting someone on the spot to say, that's unfair, that person wasn't prepared. If for some reason it is the last reading of an ordinance or something that we are expecting to pass, and there can be extenuating circumstances, I think, like you are describing. But I think as a general rule, the understanding should be that it's in the spirit of preparation.
Yeah, exactly. And a lot of these were probably issues that other councils dealt with that perhaps this council hasn't dealt with, at least not in some time. But people can use questions politically. They can try to throw a monkey wrench in the process by doing that intentionally. And so it's just, again, it's a courtesy. No one's going to be in trouble if they don't. But preparation before the meeting, I think, is something we all would deal as a professional courtesy. The order of business is exactly as it's been. We did add one item, public forum / appearances / special presentations. So we're going to get to that. We already do it this way, but this is, again, just formalizing it slightly. Wanted to highlight on page 6 at the bottom under decorum. We're asking that everybody, including the public, abide by the following rules of civil debate. You may even want to post these somewhere. They are, we may disagree, but we will be respectful of one another. All comments will be directed to the issue at hand, and personal attacks will not be tolerated. So, again, this very rarely comes up, but if it does, this is important. Use of electronic devices. City officials are to recognize that use of electronic devices to communicate with other city officials or members of the public, for example, texting during a meeting on topics being considered, may constitute a violation of Iowa's open meeting laws, and this activity is prohibited. So I can't text somebody during the discussion about the discussion. And none of us should be doing that. It's down to, all right, this is more common courtesy. The council member desiring to speak shall address the presiding officer, be recognized, and that when that person has the floor, they're not to be interrupted. Any person in the public who wishes to speak must also secure permission from the presiding officer, and remarks are limited to the matter being considered. Public would have 5-minute speaking time unless additional time is granted. All remarks should be addressed to the council as a whole, not to any individual member. And if a council member has a question for somebody speaking, they simply, again, come back to the presiding officer to get permission to speak. And then the group presentation are for organized groups wishing to present something longer than 5 minutes. And so they'd have 10 minutes to present, 5 minutes for questions. We get this sometimes with groups like FIDA or whatnot. So, and then finally, we're talking about committees. Just a reminder, committee has no authority on its own. Committee is just to give advice or recommendations to the full council, which also comes back into that council members have no authorities as individuals. So I'm the committee, the personnel committee chairman, but that gives me no authority to berate or contact a city employee on my own behalf to tell them that they're not doing their job properly. The only power that the council has is as we vote with a quorum and a majority quorum.
Yeah, just a point. some of our committees do have power. For instance, I think Ways and Means can approve expenditures up to a certain amount, $500 or something mm-hmm. like that. So that this doesn't really accurately reflect what's here. I don't know how to want to replace that. For example.
Except otherwise specified by the Code of Ordinance. Did you read it?
Well, I didn't see that portion, but I'm not sure that's in our Code of Ordinance. I think that's an understanding, like a rule. A rule. It's not an ordinance here. So, I mean, I suppose it's good to do these things, but it's in some ways I feel like, you know, like. Do we have to post things as to talk about talking nice or something? I don't really think that's necessary. I haven't seen the need for that.
Well, know? I think that having a set of standards is fine. I actually think it is up to the mayor to instruct a public hearing in the manner that they are allowed to talk and not allowed to talk. It's pretty rare, you know. It takes usually somebody being gaveled twice to be asked to be removed from the council chambers. But usually, people are pretty good about it. But I don't know that we can necessarily control emotions in certain issues in certain situations. So guidelines are fine. Those people who have that level of responsibility within themselves to express themselves within those guidelines are fine. But if they go outside the guidelines and it gets to be too much. That's what this is for.
Well, again, I don't have a problem with these rules, but I'm not sure I would agree to actually post them as far as your rules of decorum. The other thing, I'm not sure it's in here under committees, but this is something that I personally have been a little derelict on, and I'm not sure how much it's kept up. But the actual submission of meetings by the chair of the committee in writing. The minutes in writing. Some people are better than others on this, and no one has complained if I don't do it. And often it happens, especially if we have a meeting right before the council meeting, we give a little report, and then it's kind of over. But I do think it's only fair to the public if we're talking about some policy in committee that we have those minutes that are actually published on our website that people can go back and look through. And so I would. If it's not clear, I haven't seen it clearly in here. Is it, Mike?
All right. So this doesn't have, this isn't an all-encompassing. This references the Iowa code, where you would find that. And, yeah, that is actually legal requirement that we post the minutes of all our open meetings.
Yeah.
All of them, even task force. And so.
So you didn't feel it was necessary to mention it?
No. I mean, okay. It's a given. Again, this isn't going to be everything, but. The truth is, this actually is supposed to be a public document for the purpose of not just we know how we do things, but the public knows as well.
Sure.
If I want to address the council, then I would address them as a whole. I wouldn't single out an individual council member, et cetera. All right, we're almost done. There is something for the chair that we ask that, excuse me, resolution and ordinances, that the vote be done as roll call. And the reason is a resolution list the council members and then has an aye or a nay or abstention column. So we feel like calling the roll is a bit more formal, and ordinances, because they're city laws, should be done the same way. And here's another issue that we have to come up with. This actually recommendation was that instead of a simple majority, they one recommendation is to have a supermajority to waive the rules to skip ordinance readings. So I wanted to address that, and committee didn't decide. We didn't decide one way or another. We thought we'd ask the full council. How do you feel about when we decide to waive the rules and pass ordinances from, say, first to third or second to final, and we skip one? Is a simple majority enough? Is a supermajority necessary? Any thoughts on that one? What do you guys think?
I've thought about that. Since we talked about this at the meeting, having to have a requirement of 5 council members in order to suspend the rules is kind of excessive or draconian, I would think, because if for whatever reason we only have 4 council people available at that meeting, one of us is out of the country completely, another is homesick, this is a non-controversial issue, you get a chance for
trying to move it through. You hadn't had any problems previously with it.
You could do it by percentage or something. It has to be a simple percentage.
Well, just a simple majority, I think, is all we really need to do this. And I think if you put a higher restriction on it, it's going to make it even more difficult when it comes to those types of ordinances that don't need to have the full three readings.
I mean, I agree. I think a simple majority is enough.
Changing an ordinance to add a stop sign at an intersection, is that something that would really need to have three readings of an ordinance? And if you only had four council people here, you could not move that forward at that time. You'd have to either postpone it till the next meeting or just do the regular reading and move it ahead to the next.
Any other thoughts? That's the last thing that we have to actually agree on before we adopt this.
I want to make a comment on the resolution and ordinances. I disagree that resolutions would necessarily need to be a voice vote because there's a listing of names at the bottom of the resolution. I think that once you called for it, we have a record of how people voted, and that's how it's recorded on the resolution. My rule of thumb, again, you know, from a meeting management standpoint, a lot of it has to do with time. But my rule of thumb is generally if there is money expenditure involved, we will do a roll call vote. And then also the ordinances, I think we generally do a roll call vote. Again, because we are determining something that is going to be, that is creating new law. And the other is that if there is something that is, controversial in some way and there's going to be some discussion and the vote is going to be determined based on how others may be voting, then I'll allow that to go to a roll call vote as well. But if there is something that ties it to a best practices in Iowa code, I'd be fine with it.
Well, it's really up to you as the chair.
Let me put something in front of you. I did look over the rules, and I think what you're talking about here is going to bump heads at times with parliamentary procedure, mm-hmm. which is our guide in between the lines on this stuff. There's two or three areas where you have two-thirds of your vote required under regular parliamentary rules, and so the supermajority spelling out five relates to the full House, but the two-thirds on your parliamentary procedure refers to the two-thirds of your quorum.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a difference there, too.
John, are you saying this is what's already in Iowa code or something?
I'm saying that's in Robert's Rules of Order.
This is Robert's Rules of Order.
So you dictate or you say in your own ordinances that you will follow parliamentary rules of procedure generally. You can be less formal anytime you choose to, but essentially if the mayor's looking for guidance beyond me or I'm not here, I'm your parliamentarian, but I'm going to go back to a chart like this.
We usually keep a booklet here of rules of order. I don't know if we've got one in hand. That's the open meetings booklet.
You'll have some contradictions between
Yes.
five and the way that you
look. Okay.
Thank this you. Is just what I was getting at as far as
suspending the rules.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought it should be two-thirds, whoever's in set, who's ever
right.
in place.
So if there's four of us here, then three of us have to agree to suspend the rules.
But that's a simple majority as well, because if it's two and two, it wouldn't work.
Right.
But if there was six there, then it would require
four.
Yeah.
Approximately.
Yeah.
4 points.
Which is a simple majority as well. So it's kind of a moot point, but.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Well, how does council feel about roll call with resolutions and ordinances?
I agree with the mayor. I think it's not necessary to take all the time for every resolution. I think it's obvious from our votes what if we're voting yes or no, and we certainly have opportunity to speak up if we're voting no. So I think it's just taking time, and it's going to cut down on our ratings if the meeting goes so long.
I will say that a fellow council member who shall remain nameless missed a vote last meeting that was done by all in favor, and so his, he or her the name was probably listed as an aye, but there was no vocalization because it just happened so quickly. So that's the other side of doing it quickly, is somebody scratches their leg, they might miss it. But yeah, again, this is, you know, as a chair, it's up to you.
Well, everyone should speak up if there's, obviously, you're elected officials and you should make a point. You can stop that process at any point in time. Yeah.
All right, almost done. This one's interesting. Amending a motion. Now, when somebody makes a motion and then somebody says, oh, I want to offer a friendly amendment, and then it comes back to the person who originally made the motion, if they say, I don't accept that amendment, right, that's not the end of the discussion. Right. And a lot of people misunderstand. They think that person has that power to either say yes or no. If they say no, then there's another vote.
There's a motion on the amendment itself, taken before
the other
amendment.
One.
Yep. Right.
So that's got it.
Yeah. We've used that in the past. We've had that kind of situation come up. And that's a Robert Rules element to.
Yeah. But a lot of people kind of think that the person can say no, the person who made the original motion, and that's the end of it. But
and the reason I know that is because I had third graders in here on Tuesday.
They were mumbling
things. And when we have the third grade in here every year, we put them up on the council dais and we teach them how to open the meeting, take a roll call, and discuss an issue with a roll call vote. So someone actually wanted to change the original motion, and I'd ask the person if they accepted it, and they said no. So we had the vote taken, and they didn't get a second, and they also learned that that motion died there, so it went on. So
this
was just fresh
really
in
handy,
my mind with third graders.
Yeah, you could have handed this 12-page document. Motion to postpone is different than motion to table, so if you want to postpone something until the next meeting, you say motion to postpone rather than motion to table. Little things like that, and we don't interact with anyone in the process of suing the city. John Morrissey told me that as soon as somebody says they're going to sue, you stop talking to that person. That is that's just good legal advice. So there you have it, for what it's worth.
Okay, well,
and again, we can make a condensed version of this that deals with the public, so then, you know, everyone's on the same page and cordial and civil.
Great. So then what has been presented this evening is, are we looking to vote on that this evening or with some of the discussed amendments?
Well, I think we struck the majority for, there were two issues. One was, do we want a more than a simple majority? We said no.
Yeah. Okay.
And then the other one was, do we want minimum attendance? And we said no to that as well. So should be good to go if everyone agrees. Or a majority agrees.
Okay. So I entertain a motion then to approve the rules of procedure.
Move to approve the rules of procedure.
Moved by Hallie.
Second.
Second by Hamilton. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
I knew it.
Hallie.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Revolinsky.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Motion passes unanimously, and we appreciate the work that Councilman Halley and the committee has done on this.
Get your copy, John.
Next, council will move to a resolution considering support and local match for a proposed housing development. And this housing development is essentially one that we have already looked at in terms of property and what the local match commitment would be, because we have some new developers. So, Martha, any comments on that?
Yes, we were very pleased when the Economic Development Committee met with four individuals. I guess there were four. There are five of them, I think, involved. But we were very pleased with these individuals that came to us on this project, because we'd been so optimistic earlier when a man from Mount Pleasant, Mr. Hobart, had indicated that it was going to happen. And I think this is a very, very positive situation. And so we definitely would very much like to have the council approve this. And I think because of the time frame, we were very anxious. Fortunately, Mike worked with us and worked with John to be sure that we could get this to the council tonight to ask for the council's approval regarding, in terms of being sure that we can be supportive of them in getting the, you know, grant that they're hoping for. And so I guess I would just say it's certainly very positive for the community.
Yes, thank you, Martha. And Mike, would you be able to remind the council about what our proposal is in terms of the local match commitment?
Thank you, Mayor. Essentially, we are committing to do what we've already said that we would do. We're offering tax abatement to these developers, and we abate the first $75,000 of a new residential home that's built in the city. Typically, that moves through council, and we've passed the ordinance to do so. And so the abatement that's captured in that first $75,000 of taxable valuation will more than make up for the $1,000 per unit match that they're asking from the city at this time. It is possible the developer will reapproach the city down the road for some different agreements if this application with Iowa Economic Development Association is successful. But at this time, the council is simply committing to provide the normal tax abatement that we already provide to any other homeowner building within the city.
Thank you, Mike.
Okay, thank you, Mike.
You're welcome, Mayor.
I understand one of our developers is here. Any comments on the project itself? Or
just thank you for your consideration. We're anxious to get our project moving forward. On behalf of neighborhood builders and developers, we really appreciate the opportunity to work with the city.
Great, thank you.
I don't think we've defined what is being proposed here to the public.
I was going to say also we can just describe where the project is. And
can we take it, Mayor?
Thanks, please.
So the project, right now they're looking at the what we call the Bob Daniels property. So over by the, I believe it's the New Life Church, if I remember correctly. That parcel of land that's both south and east of the church, they're looking at building along Lincoln Street. The first units constructed would move along Lincoln Street and sort of progress to the east along Lincoln. That would be phase one. Phases two and three would then progress north and or possibly east-west in that particular area if phase one proceeds as they expect. So very similar to what was proposed by Mr. Hobart in his initial presentation to the council. I believe 15 units in phase one, give or take, and then if that's successful, they'll continue to build both north and then east-west within that area.
Are these single-family dwellings?
Can you come to the microphone, sir?
Sure.
Thanks.
Thank you. We're proposing to get started with some duplexes and fourplex or townhome type units. We've got an aggressive timeline. We want to be building in the spring, and we put together a behind the scenes. We've done our homework. We put together a very diverse group of investors, and this is something that we want to make happen for City of Fairfield. We've looked at a number of communities, and we felt we had a great opportunity. We know the city needs it, and we have a local flavor with some of our members, and we're really looking forward to getting started.
If I may make a
sure.
comment, I think it's a great project, but the council should be aware that it's going to require some rezoning there. Part of the area along the frontage road along Highway 1 is zoned commercial right now, and that would turn it into residential between where the church is and the bank
Grove,
there. Pilot Grove, that's the name of it,
yep.
The bank. And so, you know, on one hand, you know, that would be kind of prime commercial area to develop, you know, for the city, which would now become residential, multifamily residential. But I think whoever kind of first one in there is fine. I think whoever wants to develop it, God bless them. And I think we need the housing and all that. But I just want to point that out to the council that will require some zoning work before you can actually, proceed. But tonight, the main task was to allow the group to get some special tax credits, or is it what
workforce housing? Workforce housing tax credits. We're, right. we're making application to the state,
and right.
This is essential to our project to make it work. We have target numbers that we're working on to provide affordable housing to the city and make it attractive. And this is the first step in that process. We'll be coming back to the council, of course, with preliminary platting and so forth. We're working with French Reniker on that phase. So we hope to have a lot more answers for you here in the very near future.
Adam Flagey, who's our former FITA director, is actually a partner in this project. And he was going to write up some language and went into the letter that we were writing for them. And one thing that he wanted to make sure was that that we're not saying, well, we're only going to offer tax abatement. That's the only thing we would offer. But as the project proceeds, we get a development agreement with the developers. Possibly they're looking at possibly a TIF and us to help put in additional sewer and
the infrastructure
and
roadway, sewer and road, water.
Is this LMI housing? Is any of it going to qualify for that?
Anyway, I think it's a valid project. I would move that we support the resolution to provide the letter to help them get their tax credits.
Second.
Definitely.
Moved by Revolitsky, second by Anderson. Any other discussion?
No.
I also do agree that this is part of what we can do as a city to lend support, particularly in this early phase and application. So it's important that we show that. Any other discussion? Not all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next, Council, we have second reading of Ordinance 1145, and this is regarding the TIF project for North Campus Village. And this will be essentially the ordinance allows for the collection and payment of funds for the payment of principal interest on loans, monies advanced to, and indebtedness, including bonds issued or to be issued incurred by the city. This is our second reading. I'll open up the public hearing at this time and ask if there's any public comment. Okay. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Council, any comments on this proposed TIF project? Not entertain a motion to approve the second reading.
Move to approve.
Moved by Revolinsky. Moved by Rasmussen. R. Rasmussen.
Second.
Second by Thompson. Discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Revolinsky?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Next, Council, we'll move to our first reading of the replace and repeal for the lodging housing regulations. And this is the work that was done by our special committee recommending an ordinance to govern and put some regulations in place also for short-term rentals, a la Airbnb, or some of those other services. So this will be our first official reading on this. I know we had a good discussion at our last council meeting. So I'd open the floor at this time to any public discussion on the first reading. Okay, seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Council. Thoughts? Any since our last meeting?
I just wanted. Yes. Oh, sorry.
Okay.
I just wanted to clarify how this affects those that are currently in operation. Are they going to be grandfathered in, or are they going to operate under the new ordinance, or how does that?
Go ahead, Mike.
Sure. So our council can speak, but typically the variances run with the property that have been granted, and so the Board of Adjustment has heard and considered those requests already from those property owners, and those variances and special uses and so on and so forth run with the property, and so they would be grandfathered into this ordinance.
So if they were approved, they continue. If they were denied, the denial holds.
Correct.
Okay.
They would
unless they fall into a category where it is approved.
Right. Where it is approved
right.
via
right.
this.
Right. So if it was a zoning issue, and if they were denied in an R2 and this is passed, and which allows it in an R2, then it would change.
It would be changed. Okay.
Yeah.
So this would supersede Board of Adjustments?
Well, in terms of past decisions, I just...
Past decisions, right.
Yeah, but the...
So variances would still have to be heard, right?
They're still very much in play when it comes to variances for other zoning areas that are not approved in this ordinance.
Okay.
Mayor, if I could speak to that real quick. So the way this ordinance is written is that it's a shall issue by the Board of Adjustment, that it's no longer an arbitrary decision. If the property owner meets a very set of clear criteria outlined in the ordinance, the permit is a shall issue by the Board of Adjustment. Right. It's no longer if, what if, or the right. subjectiveness of making that decision. It's a shall issue permit as long as they meet the criteria outlined in the ordinance.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor.
Go ahead, Council.
Would it also be accurate to say that if a variance was denied for an ordinance that's now replaced, that variance, that denial of that variance is no longer valid? Does that make sense?
If that's what they were just saying. The denial doesn't
stand. The ordinance has changed, then the variance is no longer necessary.
Or they'd reapply.
Yeah, reapply with the new ordinance. Yeah. Okay. So my one issue with this, and it came up when we discussed it last time, I was trying to look over Chief's head and see the large portions of our town that are R1. And I'm thinking,
what color?
That light green on the southeast part of town. And thinking, and the light green in the west, it's quite a bit. That looks like about at least
a third,
not maybe a third, but maybe a quarter. That's a large area to deny these outright, in my opinion. So can someone speak to why we should have a rule on our ordinance that says no R1? Or where that idea came from? Is it a best practice? Is there a reason for it, a good reason for it?
The reason why the everything is timing in life, right? The reason why the committee adopted that is because we wanted to create a sense of continuity within the neighborhoods. And we figured that that particular zoning was single-family residents, and that if there was a decision made by a single-family resident that they wanted to operate in Airbnb, that they would need to get a variance on that would allow that process to go forth with a little bit more scrutiny. So it was a matter of kind of prioritizing that area towards single-family and less towards high volume of transient traffic.
I think also from discussions that I sat in on, also it was a matter of a concern about people raising concerns about a lot of those kinds of activities across the city changing the character of those neighborhoods in a way. So I think that was erring on the side of protecting the character of some of those more controlled neighborhoods, restrictive neighborhoods.
Well, knowing that a person in R1 could potentially seek a variance to allow it, I see that it's not necessarily, it's not a wall, so to speak. There might be a doorway for them to get through if their neighbors weren't objective.
Right, and they would go through that the process. And Mike, if you could refresh the council on if someone does apply for a variance, how that process is undertaken and what takes place.
Thank you, Mayor. So once we receive the request and the fee from the property owner, we then find the section of the code, the specific section that they're requesting a variance to. We publish notice in the paper. We send out a notice by certified mail to all property owners within 200 feet, and that's the eccentric or the concentric boundaries of their property. And we notify them of the time and place of the meeting, and then we hold the meeting in front of the Board of Adjustment, and they make a determination if there essentially is a hardship, is what they're looking at for variances by and large. Is there a hardship that would necessitate a variance or a deviation from this particular section of the code?
Hardship?
Correct.
Can you give an example of a hardship?
So, for example, if we, property owner wanted to build a home on a lot and they didn't meet the setbacks, and that particular lot was narrow or triangular or unique, they could say there's a hardship exists because they cannot build on that lot, so they're deprived economic benefit of owning that lot. that would be an example of a hardship.
Well, someone.
So it doesn't really relate to this particular issue, but in other words, by definition, that's why someone would come.
I have a comment on this. I definitely see the need for, you know, making sure that, you know, these things like off-street parking, that, you know, there's certain kind of, what do you call, standards that are maintained in these kind of facilities in the city. I can understand the need to register with the city so that we can maintain these standards, so that we can function in that way to help ensure the community has those standards. But ultimately, once you think, okay, so they have to pay $80 plus $30 extra per unit per year for this permit, but then that's a yearly fee as well that they pay. I would think that it would be more in terms of, I look at this like a home occupation permit. Someone's having a business out of their home. Someone's having, you're shaking your head, no way, it's like, I'm losing my train of thought here. So you can, you know, anyway, that's my own personal feeling that, yeah, it should be, we should look at it at the start of it. Is this appropriate? Is it, are these kind of guidelines followed? Or are these standards met? But then do we need to charge that, you know, that fee every year? You know, the home occupation fee is, I think, $50 a year, right? If we just keep it more under that, are we promising in this ordinance that we're going to actually inspect these units? Are we?
Yes, that's correct. Scott, do you want to speak? I'm sorry, Matt.
Go ahead. That's fine.
I was going to ask Scott if he could speak to the inspection process that we go through for our lodging houses and boarding houses.
It's going to be the same as rental housing inspection?
It'll be virtually the same as rental housing. I'll go in and check for fire safety things, exits, egress.
And is that something that you need to do every year, or you plan to do every year under this?
We'll be doing it every 4 years.
Every 4 years.
Get those in, and the fee will be there, yep, but the actual inspection will be every 4 years.
And I could see under that rental housing ordinance, inspection ordinance, we have, there are certain fees that landlords pay at the time of the inspection. You pay for the fee to get your certificate that you've re-upped. So anyway, I'm just trying to think from the point of view of the entrepreneur, the homeowner who wants to have this, and that it's a value. It does offer value to have more kind of this housing available. And I understand Rustin wants to, you know, get more hotel motel tax, and I guess we have to.
Well, it's not just getting more tax. It's also creating a level playing field for the other people, the other businesses who rent. To out people who come from out of town as well.
Sure. So,
John, just to move, just in the spirit of moving along, are you? Yeah. Do you want to make a proposal on the fees themselves? Is that something?
Yeah, I guess
that you'd like
what
to?
I would say is what I would like to see. I would make an amendment that I would like to see the initial fee being as stated, and then the yearly fee be just simply the home occupation permit fee.
So the initial fee is $80 and
plus $30 a unit.
Right.
And then from there on, it's a home occupation fee. Now, I mean, the rental housing inspection fee is how much?
$80 for the first unit and $50 for each
every 4 years.
Yeah.
Maybe it's.
Now with lodging, it is $80 every year with $30
for each additional unit.
Well, I guess I didn't come with a clear amendment here, but it was just an idea that, something to do more in the direction of
reading. So we want to read that over and come up with another.
You'll be fine.
Now that, come prepared for your meetings, John. See, now this wouldn't have worked. John, he has a legitimate concern that he wants to bring up.
But, and now he's going to leave the country.
Right. Fortunately, we do have another reading.
Okay,
so we are still looking for a motion to approve the first reading of the ordinance.
I would so move that the first reading be approved.
Okay, moved by Rasmussen to approve.
Second.
Second by Anderson. Any other discussion? Now, please call the roll.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Revelinsky?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Great, thank you. Council, I wanted to make an official notification that today is our city administrator's birthday. Mr. Harmon will not disclose his age, but it is his official birthday today. My birthday gift was to have him out of here by 8:30. We've got closed session, so our city attorney's on notice. We'll get through the rest of our agenda. But happy birthday, Mike. We really appreciate you being with us this evening and not copping out.
It's in the rules of procedure.
Good. Council, I just also wanted to make brief notice that I can't help but when something as horrifying hits home when two police officers are shot and killed in Des Moines, that we think about those who protect our community and recognize them and thank them for the work that they do for us and they have to do, that they raise their families here, their children go to our schools, they share everything in our own community life along with us. They are community members. They are not separate members of society. Those are people who have chosen the noble profession of providing the service to keep us all safe and orderly as a community. And I just want to say that on behalf of the city chief, we express that appreciation and thanks to all of the officers, and we will continue to help in every way that we can as elected officials and representatives of the community at large to build those bridges of understanding that we all need more and more in society.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We did have the opportunity. There was, as always, a strong outpouring in Fairfield. We did take 9 officers to the funerals Monday and then 6 officers Tuesday. And got to witness the outpouring of the rest of our Iowa community. And I think it was a tragedy to have to go through to attend those funerals. But the support from the community and the hundreds and thousands of people stopping on the interstate to salute, I think it really helped to see the support, not only that we always see in Fairfield, but statewide. But I do thank everybody and thank you.
Thank you, Chief. And we thank you for attending our meetings to keep us safe in a very direct way, too. Appreciate that very much. We'll move to our committee reports, Ways and Means Committee. Tom?
Yes, we have some minutes there. We did have a meeting late last week. The city has been asked by the Iowa Insurance Division if they would like to become a member in a action, I would call it that, as much as anything, against the pool manager that we've used for, 10 to 12 years, if I remember right, I think that was right. Mm-hmm. And essentially, to cut this short, the Iowa Insurance Division, even though we were very happy with the pool results, with what we had, the fees that we were paying for the insurance coverage were less than what we could get through the normal course with Wellmark. So it was accomplishing the objective. But evidently, the Iowa Insurance Division did not think that our insurance agency or pool manager was properly reporting the commissions that they were receiving, even though the city and all of their was we knew very well that they were receiving commissions. They weren't doing this for free. And that the commission, the rate that they would receive, I think we did check with Tom Gamuth. Is that right?
That's correct.
I mean, we don't know exactly what the commission is, but it's well within the bounds of what almost all group insurance is. And we did have Joy and Mike, and I think John Morrissey also attended a meeting in Des Moines. I mean, so we have some time and effort invested in this. And I think and I'm not trying to speak for John there, but I think the opinion of the committee members was we're more than happy with our service. I mean, the action that they were going to take, we just couldn't see from a city standpoint what we were going through. So our recommendation is to not participate in this action. And we don't know what the other roughly 30 members are, but I think the take they said from the meeting that day was that's probably going to be the overall decision, too.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Other
council members outside of Ways and Means agree with that.
Mike was there, Doug was there. Anybody else have anything?
Okay, great. Thank you. We appreciate the report. Anything else, John?
No.
Okay,
no.
So we're in the committee. Great. Next, we'll move on to the Personnel Committee.
We met last week, and we talked about the rules of procedure. We also talked about a tradition that historically the city administrator has granted half day off for full-time city employees the day prior to Thanksgiving and the day prior to Christmas Eve.
Christmas Eve itself.
And this is done because public bodies cannot give bonuses. There are no bonuses for our hardworking city employees. So this is done as it's administrative leave. It's paid time off, but it gives them a chance to spend more time with their families, travel to see their families for holidays. Really feels like the least we could do. So Mike, in keeping with transparency, wanted to bring it to committee and then the council to get official permission to continue this this tradition this year, and committee unanimously supported it.
Okay. So I'd make a motion, entertain a motion then to support the administrative leave for two half days, one connected to Thanksgiving, the other connected to Christmas.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Hallie, second by Anderson. Discussion? Not all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, Economic Development Committee. Martha, anything other than what we discovered
basically
tonight?
Basically, it's been covered, you know, between the council's approval and the report.
On those two projects. Thank
yes,
you.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It. Mm-hmm. Public Safety and Transportation Committee. Katie.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We met prior to this evening's meeting and had four agenda items tonight that we discussed. The first was brought to us by the school board, or a representative of the school district actually asking for, if you can, for those of you that can see the map, they're asking for the current flip down. Chief Thomas, can I use you as my pointer? The current flip down that is currently on E Street on the east side of Washington School. They're asking to place permanent signage there with hours stated for when that road will be one way before and after school. And then as well down on the southwest corner, a do not enter while that road is being used as a one-way for school drop-off and pickup. The committee saw no concerns with it. They gave us samples of the signs. They currently have to send somebody out four times a day to take the sign, flip it open, and then go back and shut it. And so what they're proposing is this, and the only thing that we ask is that they added during school hours or while school is in session, so that during summer and holidays, those people living on that road would know they can drive both directions. So we've encouraged him to go forward and proceed with that, just moving the temporary signs into a permanent sign situation. Okay. It's already in practice. So we also were, since I've got you there, I'm going to move to the sign at 20th and Jackson, if you can, Jason. At 20th and Jackson, there is a business, and we have... Do you want to speak we have a business in the bottom left of the screen that is having some concerns by employees who are exiting to the east and then going north up to the highway. And that currently is an unsigned intersection. And with lunch and then at the end of the workday traffic, we've had a request to place some sort of signage there. So if there is incident, it's at least signed. The committee is going to present you with a resolution at the next meeting for northbound traffic traveling south, or north traffic
southbound
from the north traveling
traffic.
Southbound
yeah.
To have a yield sign at that corner. And even though all we have is the compost site on the south corner of the picture, anybody traveling north would have a stop sign to clarify any concerns. Chief Thomas informed us that the unwritten or the unsigned law is that the person coming from the north traveling south would have to yield to that right person anyway. So
right. Okay.
We intend to place a yield sign. The stop sign for the compost site is actually on private property. Daryl, we already have permission to place that. So one more, Chief Thomas, you're not done.
Anna White.
And then our last request was for some sort of sign at Maple and Fillmore. So there are a number of houses that are to the south of Fillmore at the intersection of Maple and Fillmore, and there's actually a subdivision that's currently off screen. Again, an unsigned corner off that kind of semicircle drive there up there, Fillmore and Maple. Currently unsigned, although it's kind of an unspoken right now that people are yielding there. Again, if there were to be incident, it's not signed. We're recommending through resolution at the next meeting a yield sign to be placed on Maple. So, and then finally, thank you, Vanna.
That's my new nickname.
That's your new nickname. The final item that was brought before us this evening was a request for ATV use on city streets following the permission that was granted by the county for ATV use within the on the county roads. The request comes from the right place in the heart, people wishing to come in and help with snow removal for some of the elderly residents in town. And those in attendance at the committee saw no harm in at least considering it. So we are looking back to the person who initiated this request to come before us with samples of other cities that allow ATVs in their communities on the roads.
Okay, thank you, Katie, appreciate it. So we'll have all of those coming back in the form of resolutions or ordinances. So,
yes.
Okay, great.
Mike will draft those for us.
Thank you. All right, you can roll on to your ambulance report.
Ambulance committee met, and I apologize, I don't have the date in front of me, earlier this month. Pretty short and relatively low-key meeting. We did discuss the changes proposed by Mr. Morrissey on behalf of the city to the contract, and the ambulance committee is taking that back to their legal counsel, and we will officially vote on it at the next meeting. We, the council, addressed this, I think it was this summer, mm-hmm. and we're just now moving forward with that. The other good news for Ways and Means purposes is the agency has agreed to lower our contribution for the agency, and rather than $25,000 next year, we're looking closer to $22,000 or $23,000. So we're making a step in the right direction.
Great.
All right.
Thank you, Katie. Appreciate your reports. Next, we'll move to our administrator and department reports. Like anything in particular? Or
just a quick point of order, Mayor. The council decided to hold a meeting on December 5th. We'd just like to clarify if the intent is to hold that at noon or to hold that at 7 p.m. on Monday.
Okay. I guess be open either way. The assumption was it would be at the same time as a regular meeting, but people prefer to meet during the day. Since it will be just to consider
quick items.
Right. Yeah.
Our regular meeting is going to fall on the 19th.
Yes.
Then,
I could meet that night, but not at noon.
So we'll do keep it in the evening at a regular time?
I'll be here.
Okay.
I'll be back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. 7 p.m. on the 5th.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
Good.
Okay. That's all.
And Daryl, did you have something to report on snow routes?
Yes, I think in your package you should have a map of just a little bigger one. Something that we've considered this year through my assistant and through Mike is having some priority routes of snow removal. Whenever we go out to plow, we're going to change up the routes. Instead of like double teaming, we're going to have single guys go out, and that way they're not held up by waiting for another truck. We can just go down the road, and sometime a truck can do three passes and they'll clear the road. We've got some bigger plows now. We've got some 12-foot plows. We've got an 11-foot plow. So this map is arterial routes around town, and the maps are made such as there shouldn't be anybody any further away from a priority route than about three blocks. So when we go out to plow, everybody will do the priority routes first, and then they can move to the rest of their route. So we think it'll be smoother and it'll be faster plowing the streets, and then we'll go to doing our sanding and stuff. But it's just something for your information. We're making this proposal that we make this priority route. It's not going to be signed or anything else. It's just going to be understood. These are priority routes. And so we've tried to take the arterial routes so people can get quicker downtown going to those places, and then we'll do the rest of the route. Normally it takes 5.5 to 6 hours to plow the town. We think we can cut that down to about four.
Good.
I mean, that's what we're thinking about. And we think we can do that better, and then we're just going to try to see how that works. It doesn't mean it's set in stone, but we can change this. But just for your information, we do it. It's like if it's not going to be signed, it's not emergency routes, it's just priority routes for your information.
Great. Thank you, Darrell. We appreciate the department coming up with this and creating an efficiency that hopefully will get us all to work quicker in schools. Hey, Council, that takes us to the end of our in-session agenda. We have a closed session scheduled, so I would entertain a motion to go into closed session as per Iowa Code 21.5J.
Who will make that motion?
Moved by Thompson.
Yeah. Second.
Second by Hamilton. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign.